Hey, welcome to my channel. My name is Kara, and today I wanted to share a little bit with you about how children read. I know there are tons of moms out there right now who are stressed because the schools are closed and they are at home with their kids trying to teach them. They might have little ones who are at the age where they want to start to learn to read and they just don't know how. I've received many questions from a couple of moms out there saying, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to teach my child to read. I don't even know where to begin. So coming from a teacher and a mom's perspective, I want to share a little bit with you about how children learn how to read and to give you some tips and ideas and different activities that you could use at home to help your child learn to read. I am actually going to make this part one, and I'm also going to have a part two to this video. I'm going to share a little bit from what I learned in college and the different ways that children learn, but then I'm also going to share a little bit of practical ideas mixed with some activities that you could do. So I invite you right now to join me for part one and follow up with part two later on. All right, let's jump in. Before we get into all of the nitty-gritty of good reading instruction, I wanted to share a little bit with you about my background, because there are going to be many people watching this video who know nothing about me, have never seen any of my previous videos. So I am a former public school teacher. I also taught in the private school setting, and I now teach my children at home. I attended the University of Florida, the College of Education, which is considered to be one of the best teacher colleges in the nation. I graduated with a bachelor's and a master's degree in education with a focus in elementary education. Reading was actually one of my favorite subjects that I was able to take in college, and we had an amazing reading professor who just truly instilled a love of reading instruction into all of us. UF also has a really amazing program called UFLI, the University of Florida Literacy Initiative, which takes a lot of what I'm going to talk to you about today and incorporates it into an entire program that they implement all over. And it's really, really beneficial, especially for beginner readers and struggling readers. I actually took out some of my old college textbooks and kind of looked through those and wrote down some notes so I wouldn't miss anything to teach all of you. But first, I wanted to mention that there are actually many different philosophies on teaching children how to read and when to start instruction and all of that. So there's lots of different information and different time frames and just so much. But there are five main areas of good reading instruction, and those are phonological and phonemic awareness, phonics, vocabulary, fluency, and comprehension. I'm going to explain each one of those separately and kind of add in some different activities and suggestions that you could do at home. But first, I wanted to share a little bit with you about the importance of reading aloud. So everyone gets that reading aloud is important in the younger years, right? Like when they're a baby, they're a toddler, and then maybe an elementary age. But a lot of people think after the later elementary years, middle school, high school, that reading aloud isn't as important. But let me tell you that reading aloud is crucial. It's very, very important. And I took out one of my textbooks from college, Teaching Children's Literature, that talks just on this. And I wanted to read a few quotes to you about this to kind of prove my point on this. So this one little quote here says that in a study, they found that conversation and growing up in a literate family environment where reading and writing occurred naturally gave children a big advantage over those who did not have this type of home environment. Now, teaching children to read, we don't teach them to read for test scores, right? But this here, and all of the activities that were characteristic of such homes, it was the sharing of stories that was found to be the most important. The child who scored the lowest on all of the tests was never read to. The child who scored the highest had experienced many stories and was already interested in books and written language more generally by age 2. So, like I said, we don't teach children to read so they can score well on tests. Not at all. But this shows that those who are read to generally perform better. It also says that there's an importance of motivating children to see reading as an activity that brings pleasure and fulfillment. He noted that lots of time and money were going into teaching children to read, but something must be wrong because many of them did not end up reading. So what they're saying is there's so much money and time spent on all of these different reading curriculums and all of the different reading instruction theories and all of that, but really it's not getting to the heart of the child and encouraging them to be lifelong readers. And instead it's doing the exact opposite. And it's talking about the importance of reading aloud here. And by reading aloud, they discuss that choosing good books to read aloud to your children at home actually leads to good conversations, which then the good conversations helps you to talk and develop relationship with your child. And if you do not have a good relationship with your child, then they are not going to learn from you. Developing positive relationships with your child at home is key to getting to the heart of your child for them to trust you enough to learn from you. Also, it talked about reading aloud helps children see themselves and others as readers. So essentially, you're modeling to them what is important. So by reading aloud shows to them that you think reading is important. So therefore, they will think reading is important to them as well. At least encourage them to do so. It also shows the child what proper fluency looks like. So how you read the words on the pages and the pace that you take also encourages them to learn new vocabulary words, words that maybe they wouldn't be able to sound out or they wouldn't hear, or maybe they would just skip over if they were trying to read it on their own. So if you aren't doing anything else, I strongly encourage you to be reading aloud to your children right now. But I also wanted to talk about those 5 key areas of reading instruction with you so you can better understand the progression of how children learn to read. So the first area is phonological and phonemic awareness. So trying to explain, this is a kind of a hard concept to understand, but I'm going to try to simplify it for you. So essentially, it is the way that we understand that words are made of sounds and that what we say has meaning and represents things in our world. And this is an oral language process. It doesn't require anything of you but to be speaking orally to your children. We can encourage and develop this area by singing nursery rhymes with our children. We can talk to them about rhyming words and having them come up with rhyming words and play rhyming word games. We can talk to them about different word games, so silly things like the Hanny Banny Fo Fanny Me My Mo Manny little song. It sounds so silly, but it's important for them to see how sounds and different elements of our words are changed. We can also talk to our children about syllables. So teaching syllables is important because it helps children decode words later on when they are reading actual text. So I like to clap syllables out with children, and I really like to start with their name and the names of people in our family. So for my daughter, Ava, we would say Ava. So Ava has two syllables in her name. And then we would move on to someone else in the family. So that way we are creating meaning, and it's just a fun little game to play together. So the second area is phonics. So everyone, I'm sure, has heard of phonics in one way or another. But phonics essentially is connecting letters and sounds and figuring out how the letters and the sounds connect to then make words. So by teaching our children the alphabet and how sounds are connected with certain sounds are connected with those letters as a first step. And then once they have that down, then we can move into learning how to read simple words. So a lot of people start with simple three-letter words called CBC words, like cat would be an example. So we would sound out the word cat and blend it together. We can also isolate the sounds, right? So what's the beginning sound of cat? And it's cat, it starts with the C. We can also isolate middle sounds and the ending sounds, all very important to learning how to decode and read, blend words, blend letters and sounds to make words. After CBC words, then learning about what's called CBCE words. So those are the words that have a silent E and which changes the vowel sound, right? So if we had an E on the end of here, it wouldn't be cat anymore. It would change this middle sound and it would say Kate, right? So that is important to learn. People use word families to help teach children to read these simple words. So cat would actually be in the at family, and you can change the beginning sound. We know that that says at, but every time that we change the beginning sound, it is a new word. So at, the at family, the in family, the am family, very easy. You can look those up online for yourself for some suggestions in that area. Also, a lot of people include in sight words at this time. So sight words are those words that a child cannot sound out. So there are two different types of sight word lists out there. They're very similar. They have minor differences. It's called the Deutsch word sight word list and the Frye sight word list. So you can also Google those. They will come up for you and focus on that. I highly suggest, so if you get flashcards, I suggest that you not just do flashcard sight words with each other. Really, it's boring and no fun, and it's going to seem like a chore to learn your sight words. But instead, just think of fun, creative ways to learn sight words. So maybe you can hide cards around your house and have them go find them and read the words to you. You can write them down on a little piece of paper, and right now it's close to Easter, so you could hide the little piece of paper and the Easter egg and have them go find them, open them up, read you the word. You can have them stamp sight words, write them in rainbow colors. I mean, there's all different types of things that you could do to make it truly fun and an engaging activity for them. You can also think of some other creative activities and things to teach the reading of the CBC words. So like I said, it's close to Easter right now. So I use an Easter egg for my daughter and I put the family here. So the at family, and over on this side, I wrote down different beginning sounds to change the word. So right here it's on with the B-A-T, so that's bat. And then we would twist the egg and oh, look, there's a C. So at, that makes cat. And then we learned all of our different words in the at family just by using this simple activity. It's fun, it's different. You can also buy these little books here. In the schools, they use something similar, and basically they're just early beginning readers. Basically, they just are made up of the different CVC words to read, put them together in little tiny sentences to read, and then they work their way up to more complicated, complex sentences. So this one is the fat hat. So it's working on that at family again, and just changing up the words a little bit and in ways that hopefully make sense. I will try to link some of these things down below in the description box, so you'll have quick, easy access to those. I also wanted to share with you another activity that I forgot sitting right here, but like I have puzzles too. So these are CVC word puzzles with the first words there. So like this one, dog and bug and jet and all of those, like my daughter enjoys putting these together and they are self-correcting, so she knows if she's doing it correctly on her own. And they are so double-sided, so in the beginning they can use the ones with the pictures, but then you can also turn them over like this one here and it's just the letters. So it's a little more complex when they get used to actually reading the words on their own. And this one here is another one, cow, cake. So obviously it starts with the CVC words, but they also have some of those CVC E words in the box as well.
I could actually talk all day about reading and reading instruction, but I ended up having to edit a few parts out because this video was getting really long. So I made this little graphic here for you to see. Feel free to screenshot it, or I will also post it on the blog page for this video at passioninthepurpose.com.
The next area of importance for reading instruction is vocabulary. So vocabulary is something that they can really grasp on when you're doing your read alouds, right? So they're hearing you say new vocabulary words, and a lot of times they're gonna ask you, well, what does that mean, mommy? What is that? I don't understand what that word is. And then you can explain it to them, or by giving your children new experiences, exposing them to new things will help build their vocabulary, helping them build up that background knowledge, and just pointing out new things. Like there are tons of things just in your home that you could point out to them and teach them new words. The next area is fluency. And this is something that you would be modeling also when you're reading aloud to them. And the more that they hear you read, the better they will get. The more they read, the better they will get with their fluency as well. And basically fluency is just how fast they are reading, how slow they are reading, the amount of expression that they are using when they're reading their sentences. Do they follow the rules of the punctuation, which then plays into the tone and fluctuation of their reading? So like I said, that is something that is going to be practiced and is going to get better and better the more that you read. The next area is comprehension, and we all pretty much, I think, understand what comprehension is, understanding what we are reading. And this is something that too gets better with practice, and the more we read, the better that we will get at comprehending, the better that we connect what we are reading with the real world helps as well. So when we see what we're reading and connecting that to our real life, then that will help us comprehend a little better. Ask questions to your child as you're reading or as they're reading, and that will help them probe them to think of what they are reading and how that applies to different areas. So if you're reading aloud, you can stop, ask a question. You can ask them questions before you read, and that will help them think about those questions while you're reading. And if they are reading on their own, then you can come up with questions to ask them when they're done with their reading time. Have them explain to you exactly what they are reading and what their favorite part is, and is there a special character in the story that they like, a character that they connect with. There's lots of questions that you could be asking your child to help them better their comprehension. Okay, so I know that was a lot of information thrown your way, and I hope I explained it well to you. But if you are at the point where your child already knows how to read, but they're struggling a little bit, you can go through those different areas that I talked about that are important and revisit those. So phonics instruction is probably going to be your go-to. I know a lot of children struggle in areas of phonics because they didn't get a strong foundation in that area. So just reviewing all the things I talked about with your struggling reader will be very helpful. And there's lots and lots of information that you could search for on the internet that would be helpful, like different activities and stuff that you can do. So I'm going to go ahead and end this part one of the video, and I'm going to come back in the next day and to talk to you a little bit more about the practical side of reading instruction and some different thought-provoking ideas that I think will help you when encouraging your child to read and to become a lifelong learner. So I invite you back for that one. Check out the blog post at passioninthepurpose.com. I will link all of these different activities and different suggestions on that post to help you and to give you quick access to different resources. And I also invite you to come and join me over on Facebook at Teaching Children on Purpose. It is my new closed Facebook group where I share all different types of resources and activities for teaching children. So I will see you next time.